Marie Curie, the woman who lit the world. But first, let's see how beauty became deadly.
Energy. Beauty. Healing. The secret of eternal youth. Now in a single drop. Radium elixir, the light of life.
Radium.
A magical glow, so alluring that even doctors believed in it. Would you drink it?
People did. Radium water, creams, and chewing gum. Until their bones crumbled. Until they died. In agony. But before the world understood the danger hidden in that glow, there was one woman who couldn't look away. A woman who devoted her life to the light. She didn't know that this light would one day save millions of lives and destroy her own. Her name was Marie Curie, researcher, mother, pioneer, the woman who made the invisible visible. 1867, Warsaw. Poland officially doesn't exist. It's under Russian rule. Higher education for women is forbidden. But in secret, the Flying University emerges, underground lectures in basements and back rooms. There sits a young girl, Maria Skłodowska, hungry for knowledge, defiant, and full of curiosity. Even then, she swears, "Nothing and no one will stop me." At 24, she flees to Paris. The city of lights becomes the city of hardship. A cold attic room, nights spent warming herself under piles of books, days filled with lectures at the Sorbonne, evenings with calculations, experiments, and loneliness. Then, Pierre Curie, a physicist, serious and humble, driven by the same passion. A man who doesn't belittle her, but understands her. Their wedding, simple, without jewelry. Their honeymoon, a bicycle trip across France, carrying lab samples in their bags. Two people devoted entirely to science. 1897, Irene is born. 1904, Ev. Marie lives two lives at once. She rocks her daughter to sleep while noting down measurements. She nurses while solving equations. Between nursery and laboratory, between love and science. 1898. A shed filled with dust, sweat, steam, and sulfur. Amid tons of pitch blend, Marie and Pierre discover something no one had ever seen before. A glass tube. A bluish glow, delicate as breath in the cold. Polonium. Radium. Two new elements, one named after her homeland, Poland. Radium salts glow faintly in the dark. No fire, no electricity, just energy emerging from matter itself. But the light demands a price. They haul rocks, stir, boil, filter, for months. Their hands are burned raw, their bodies ache. In 1902, Marie isolates a tiny sample of pure radium chloride, barely a tenth of a gram. A spark that would change the world. 1903, the Nobel Prize in Physics, shared with Pierre and Henri Becquerel. Marie becomes the first woman ever to receive one. But in 1906, an accident. Silence. Pierre is struck and killed by a horse-drawn carriage. Marie is left behind. Two children, a lab full of memories, and a heart that no longer beats. She doesn't give up. She takes over Pierre's professorship and becomes the first female professor at the Sorbonne. Marie Curie receives her second Nobel Prize. This time in chemistry, a triumph no one before her had achieved. But outside the lecture halls, Paris turns against her. Her relationship with physicist Paul Langevin becomes public. private letters are stolen. The press erupts. Immoral, dangerous, foreign seductress. Crowds gather in front of her house. Windows shatter, stones fly. The Nobel Committee advises her to skip the ceremony. She replies, "I see no connection between my scientific work and my private life." And she travels, proud, alone, to Stockholm. Europe burns. The First World War begins. While men build weapons, Marie Curie builds something else, hope. She develops a strange-looking vehicle few take seriously at first, an ambulance, equipped with a generator, X-ray tube, and dark room, a rolling laboratory. The soldiers call it
La Petite Curie.
The Little Curie. How does it work? Under the hood, a gasoline engine powers a generator, producing electricity the front lines never had. That current runs into a Crookes tube, a glass cylinder inside the van. Electrons strike a metal target, releasing invisible rays, X-rays. A wounded soldier lies on the table. The rays pass through his flesh. Bones and bullets stop them, leaving a shadow image on a glass plate behind him. Marie explains simply, "It's like a photograph, only it shows what's hidden inside." Minutes later, the doctor holds the developed plate. He stares, stunned. "There's the bullet, 2 centimeters from the bone. We can remove it without cutting." The soldier exhales in relief. His leg is saved. By the war's end, Curie had outfitted more than 200 such vehicles. Over 1 million wounded soldiers were examined. Tens of thousands survived because she dared to bring light into war. Not to destroy, but to heal. Curie realized that matter itself contains energy. Her research led to X-rays, radiation therapy, nuclear medicine, but also to nuclear power, and eventually, the bomb. The light she sought could save lives, or erase entire cities. She had opened a door, and behind it waited both hope and horror. 1934. Marie Curie dies of aplastic anemia caused by years of radiation exposure. Her notebooks remain so radioactive that they are still stored in lead-lined boxes. Anyone who wishes to study them must wear protective gear. Even her grave in the Pantheon of Paris is sealed with lead. Her work lives on. In 1935, just a year after her death, Irène Joliot-Curie receives the Nobel Prize in Chemistry, together with her husband, Frédéric Joliot, for discovering artificial radioactivity. Her grandchildren, Pierre and Hélène, become renowned scientists. Her younger daughter, Eve, chooses another path: writer, war correspondent, humanitarian, a family shaped by light and shadow. The dark legacy, radium as fashion. They thought it was the secret of youth. The future, bottled. But this glow didn't heal. It killed. The most dangerous chapter didn't begin in a lab, but in the spas and stores of the roaring 1920s. Radium became a fashion product. Radium baths, radium water, radium inhalations. In Paris, they even sold radium chocolate. Pamphlets promised the elixir of youth. And one of the most famous products carried a name that sounded like hope, Radithor. According to its makers, it could cure countless diseases. Its ionizing radiation, they claimed, would miraculously recharge the human body from within. Despite the high price, Radithor became a sensation. Among the wealthy, it was considered a miracle cure, a symbol of health, vitality, and modern progress. The company sold more than 400,000 bottles of its certified radium water in just 5 years. Doctors who prescribed it earned a secret 17% commission. But the miracle was pure poison. The most tragic believer was a man named Eben Byers, rich, healthy, admired. He drank 3 bottles a day. Then his jaw began to crumble. His bones followed. He died in agony at the age of 51. The Wall Street Journal headlines were brutal, and a later line became infamous. The radium water worked fine until his jaw came off. Marie Curie herself warned, "One must be careful with radium. It is dangerous in untrained hands." But profiteers made millions. Her discovery, meant to heal, had become deadly wellness. The glow of progress turned into the shadow of greed. Light and shadow. Today, Marie Curie rests in the Pantheon, the first woman to lie there not beside a man, but because of her own achievements. She made the invisible visible. She healed and paid with her life. Her work saved millions and also paved the way for destruction. Marie Curie, the mother of radiation, the healer, and the unintended harbinger of shadows.